Hello everyone, good day, and we're in for another wonderful session today, the last day of June 2020, June the 30th. And all the way from the UK, we have this top class entrepreneur, teacher of entrepreneurship, stimulator of entrepreneurship, mentor of entrepreneurs with us, Professor Akim Ajumbadi. We're going to have two lectures in a row. We're going to have a break in between after our question and answer session, and we are going to be taking industry and market analysis, followed by resourcing and finance, preparing financial projections and funding the venture. These are very important elements in principles and practice of entrepreneurship that we're taking on today. AC 814 for our master students, 914 for the PhD students. As we said, the master students will have something, both will be deep, but that of the PhD will be deeper in terms of content that they're expected to cover. So it's now my pleasure, great pleasure, of inviting again. We all know him. So I'm going to invite him straight away to take us through the first lecture on industry and market analysis. Over to you, Sir Professor Akim Ajumbadi.
Good morning, everybody.
Yes, good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Please, can you see my slide?
Very, very clearly. Maybe you want to go to slideshow.
Yeah, I'm on slideshow. Okay. Thank you so much for having me again. It's always a pleasure joining your sessions and then learning so much at the end of the day. Anytime I interact with you, I always leave a better student than I was before the session. So I want to thank you for the rich knowledge. Today we want to quickly, in about 30-40 minutes, look at industry and market analysis. Like you know, this is not something we can do within that time frame, but because I know I'm speaking with African scholars, I'm
very the best in Africa, the best.
Yes, so I'm very convinced that you are not new to some of these things, but we just want to look at how we can actually practicalize a number of them. So some of the things we'll be looking at today would be what industry analysis is, the types of industry, the impact of industry and the firm's factor on firm performance, how to assess such industry attractiveness, how do we study industry trends using the Michael Porter 5 forces model, and then the market and competitive analysis itself, how do we identify competitors, and then the different types of competitors you can possibly have, then what are some of the sources of competitive intelligence that we can make use of moving forward in our entrepreneurial endeavor, and then what are some of the ethical ways of collecting information about our competitors. So quickly, when we talk about industry, I've found that quite a lot of times the word industry has been abused by quite a lot of people. You see somebody who have just a small store, and then he will say, good industry. And how can this be an industry? You just have a small shop and you call it an industry. So that's why we need to understand that we don't have to abuse such usage, such terminology. An industry, like we know, it is a group of firms that produce similar or auxiliary products. And I will give very simple example. Look at automobile industry, for example. In an automobile industry, when you have a car, let me be precise, when you have a car, you have the tires, you have the engine, you have the upholstery, you have the fiber, you have the glass. All of these are produced by different manufacturers.
Correct.
Each component from different manufacturers. Each of the manufacturers, if you look at tire, for example, you can have Michelin, you can have Dunlop, you can have Yakaoma. That is a firm. We have different firms that produces this tire, but the firm that produces tires are all operating in an automobile industry.
Correct.
That's what an industry is. If you look at education as an industry, you have the whiteboard, you have the projector, you have everything, and you have the furniture that we use. Each of these are produced by different firms operating within the education industry. So we must understand. And if we don't understand the nature of industry we want to operate as an entrepreneur, then there is a problem, because your analysis, your market analysis, must first start from the type of industry where you operate. If you focus or you limit your analysis simply to that market, there will be a problem, because you'll be oblivious of the development in the industry, which is the bigger picture of the firm where you are actually trying to operate. So it is important that we have an understanding of that. Now, what are the different types of industries and the opportunities that we possibly have? This has been categorized into four. We have what you call the emerging industries. We have the fragmented, we have the mature and the declining ones. Now, just for the sake of emphasis, the point I note under each of the industries are the opportunities. While what you have colored in the cycle there defines what each of the industry means, so that when we are checking this in our private time, we can understand. For example, the emerging industry, we talk about industries that have standard operation procedure. They have the standard operating procedure, but they are yet to really fully develop. They are yet to fully develop. Those are the emerging industries. If you look at in Africa, for example, if you look at Africa, we have things we can call emerging industry. Unlike when we compare it to, look at robotics. The issue of robotics is not something that is part of us yet. We are yet to get there. Using chips is another thing. AI, artificial intelligence, is something that is very much coming up, but we are not there yet. But when you get to Silicon Valley in the United States, this is well developed. Venture capitalists has invested a lot of money in such. So the opportunity, what opportunity can you see in an emerging industry? The first mover advantage. If you are the first to come in, you can have a pricing strategy we call skin the cream pricing strategy. You can charge a very high price before other competitors wake up and try to join the kind of industry. Then you have what you call a fragmented industry. In a fragmented industry, they are usually characterized by large numbers of firms who have what we can call approximately equal size. I give an example. Look at the banking. In the banking sector, it is not clear-cut to say per se that, this particular bank is better than this one, or this one is stronger. What would be your yardstick? There are some banks that have been operating for quite a long time, like the First Bank of this world, that like the Union Bank. They have divested a lot of their money into different sectors. And because they have divested into agriculture, into oil, they have been able to weather quite a lot of storm over the decades. Whereas the new generation banks, they struggle. You can see that they really struggle. And when the issue of consolidation of banks came up, the new generation banks were the ones crumbling.
And they Correct.
Have about 4 or 5 merging together. So in the fragmented industry, we have firms that are almost equal sizes. Now, the opportunities that are bound in a fragmented industry is you can have what you call consolidation of merger and acquisition. For those of us who are experienced, we witnessed that the CBN government into a lot of merger when the capitalization of the banking sector or the banking industry was raised. Then we also have what we call the mature industry. These are industries that are experiencing very slow or no increase in demand. They seem to have reached their saturation stage. And look at such industries. The question you ask yourself as an operator is, why should I go into this? And I'm going to cite example of something that we can relate with. Look at education again, because I know quite a bit that there are some of us who are owners of private schools. We have some of us who are also owners of private hospitals and stuff like that. When you look at it, we have so many private schools now, so many. Now, the question you ask yourself is that, why should I start one? What will be my own niche? Except you want to tell me that in the area where you want to operate, none of such exist, or very few exist, and you think you want to catch in on such opportunity. Otherwise, we can say that it is mature, and they are all offering virtually the same. So if you want to invest, I've seen quite a lot of people that goes into retirement, and what they want to start is to start running a school, start a private primary or secondary school. The question is, the gestation period is long, because the colossal amount of money you are going to invest in the structure, and then before you nurture it, before you are able to make a name, and you want to use your retirement benefit to start a school when you are already 65, 70, does it really worth it?
No, it doesn't.
What I'm saying is that you need to have an understanding of the nature of industry you are going as an entrepreneur before you actually get into it. So you will see that the opportunity that are abound in a mature industry is where you have what you call process innovation or after sales service innovation, because you must be doing something extra that will make people to actually still want you, because that particular market is already saturated. Then you have the declining industry. In a declining industry, or industry that are said to be declining generally, well, what you have are people who are experiencing a sort of reduction, industry that is experiencing a sort of reduction in the demand for their product. Now, in 2001, when GSM was introduced in Nigeria, for example, when GSM was introduced in Nigeria, as of 2003, there were just about 2 million users of telephone, be it analog or digital, just about 2 million. But today, we have well over 88 million users, because everybody, even in the village, you have carpenters, you have fashion designers, everybody now have an Android. Nobody carry big catalogs again. They just show you everything on the phone. They send it to you either via any of these WhatsApp or Instagram. Even carpenter, everybody now use that. So when you look at it, if anybody is now going to give me a license to operate a telecommunication service in a country like Nigeria or in South Africa, I will have to think twice, given the amount of money that I need to invest, what it will cost me to get the license, and then the technicality that I involve. Will it be worthwhile? That is not to say there's no opportunity at all. But then, are there other areas I can possibly invest that will give me quick return on my investment than that? That is why you need to understand the nature of industry we are operating. However, in such a declining industry, leadership is key, because you need to have your own niche and understand what the cost reduction strategy that you can possibly use is. That will be very important. Moving forward, now, as an entrepreneur, there are certain key questions you ask yourself. It is not just sufficient for you to have an understanding of the nature of your industry, but you must also be able to answer some fundamental questions before you actually go into a particular business. The industry you want to go into, how accessible is it? You ask yourself, how realistic is it to even go into this business? For example, as somebody who has always been in academies, into management consultancy, and I now say that I want to go into pharmaceutical business, there are regulations that guide it. There are regulations. Do I have that which is required? Can I meet it? To develop a particular product, ordinary paracetamol, the research could take as much as 20 to 30 years before they even come to a conclusion. And then the spread can be all over. So the industry you want to assess, you have to ask yourself, how accessible is this industry? What are the regulations? What are the legal requirements that are involved? What is the nature of finance in that particular sector? What technology are required? You need to ask yourself, what are the positions in the industry to avoid negative attributes? So what are some of the key things that you need to bear in mind? Again, Does that industry contain markets that are very ripe enough for innovation? You must understand, is this particular industry underserved? Because before you go into any business, you must also ask yourself, what is the market gap? The market gap is the difference between the demand and the supply. If there is no market gap, there is no point going into a saturated market.
Yeah.
So you must understand that particular industry. What is that industry? You live in a particular environment, you just feel, okay, I don't see anybody doing it, then I want to go into it. Who told you they need it? Maybe they don't. So you must, this is something that we must be very clear about. They possibly don't. Now, there are impacts of industry and frame factors on performance. Now, when we talk about impact of industry and frame on organizations' performance, we look at it first from the frame's perspective. This will have to do with the asset of that particular organization, the products, what are the culture, the team, which has to do with the employees, the reputation of the organization. All this will have to do, because I don't want us to just look at startup. There are some of us that have already established and we've been in operation for quite a while. So what we are thinking of is expansion or remain small. The truth of the matter is that it is not for, expansion is not for every business. We must bear that in mind. Sometimes a business is better off remaining small than going into expansion. I was speaking with a young man, one of my former students here last week, and he told me what he has done. He started a care home some 5 years ago in the UK here. And he told me that everything was fine. In less than 2 years, he already had about 3 care homes around UK. A year later, he already have about 5. And his turnover was about £5 million. But today, he told me he closed it around December last year. And I asked him why. He said, the business grew bigger than I could manage.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, the mistake he made is that, because I had a seminar with them, and he asked a question during that seminar. It was after that particular seminar that he now called me privately, that the reason why he asked the question is this and that. So he said, because he had to travel from Coventry to Leicester, from Leicester to Birmingham, he was the one doing all this. And the problem he had was because he said he's a perfectionist and he couldn't trust the business in the hands of people. Again, we can't run a business like that. So if you are the type of person that have issues with trust, how do you manage a business that have different branches? You should know that the moment you open more stores, the truth of the matter is operational managerial ability becomes reduced, because your level of interface with your employees, with the customer, will be reduced.
Correct.
Imagine somebody who have a clinic or a hospital. You now have about 3 different hospitals or 3 different schools. You can't be there. You can't be in the 3 locations on a daily basis. Whereas your personality is what actually attracts people ordinarily. Because the after-sales service, the customer service that you give, the personal touch you give is something else. Whereas your employees are merely there for the income they want to earn. They are not as passionate as you are in that business. So sometimes you are better off remaining small until you are able to nurture the business. Even if you put your son, it is not the same, because the drive you have, the driving force, is not the same. So we must understand that it is very important that we look at what constitutes the organization's asset. What are some of the products you are offering? Then what is the nature of your employees? What reputation do you have? How can you leverage on that? Because in business, like we say in marketing, if you satisfy 10 customers, you will be lucky that they will tell the 11th customer. But if you fail one customer, you will tell 10 potential.
Oh, yeah.
So bad news spread quickly. And that is why we have to be careful, especially where you are dealing with services. Services like education, law, medical, even car wash. If I take my car to you once and I come to wash my car, and the next thing I can't find a CD, and you clean inside the car, even if that CD has been taken by my wife without telling me, and I have forgotten to ask her, I didn't know she has taken it. The natural tendency of man is to think it was stolen in that car wash. And they can spread it like that. So we've got to be extremely careful. So the industry level factor includes the kind of threat of new entrants, such as potential rivals, the bargaining powers of the buyers, which I'm going to deal with when I get to Michael Porter Five Forces. I will deal with that in there. So why this is important is that research have actually shown us that between 8 and 30% of variations in industry or in the firm's profitability is directly related to the nature of the industry where you operate. Not people you operate. So the significance of industry can also be seen in terms of available researches all over the world, whereby between 8 to 30% of the profit of a firm is actually born out of the nature of industry that a business actually operates. Look at the airline today with the COVID, with the COVID-19. Look at the airline. We were all shocked when British Airways announced the sacking of about 12,000 workers and over 4,800 pilots were served later. If it can happen to BA, now imagine the smaller airlines. And the story continues like that. And with this COVID-19, we all know many businesses will not recover. Those who will recover will take a longer time before they are able to, especially the hospitality industry. In the UK, for example, someone was asking me today, when are you coming to Nigeria? I said, I wish I know. Because if you ask me, I want to jump on the plane now. But if I have to come to Nigeria and they say I have to be on quarantine for 14 days, and I come back to UK, I'm going to be in quarantine for 14 days. 28 days inside the house when I'm coming for 1 week holiday. Of what use?
Now, sorry, Professor Jumbadi, we'll reduce your quarantine to 12 days. 12 days in Nigeria.
So the point is that you will see that even the UK is already discussing it because they know they're going to lose a lot of money. People come here for summer holiday a lot, and nobody will want to come if they have to be in quarantine for 14 days. So it's going to be a lot of money lost. Now, Dubai has been a holiday hub for quite a lot of people. As a result of this now, Dubai has changed it, trying to say that we are not going to put you in quarantine, just start coming, because they know how much they have lost. So that is the significance of understanding industry. Now, when you look at such a hospitality industry, now look at every other thing that is affected. If you are on holiday, for example, you are going to take a cab right there from the airport. So the cab drivers are going to suffer when visitors or tourists are not coming in. Hotels are going to suffer. Now, the food, there's quite a lot of stores that only operate during summer, during holiday period. They are also going to suffer. There are a lot of parks that are open for kids, which people take their kids, like the Disneyland of this world, they are going to suffer. So the multiplier effect is huge, and that is why it is important to understand the industry. Do not look at the business only from your angle. So imagine somebody who is a taxi driver, a cab driver, who only look at how many cabs are competing with me, how many cabs in this area, without having an appreciation of the industry where he operates as a cab driver. Imagine the nature of problem, which is why the industry analysis, as actually packaged by our prof, is important for us as entrepreneurs.
Good.
Again, assessing industry attractiveness. How do you assess which industry you go into? There are three things to look at. The first one is for us to study and understand the environment and then to understand the business trend. Then we look at the other one, which is the Michael Porter Five Forces. Now, the first one, like I said, is the understanding the environmental trend. The environmental trend is a macro variable. We have quite a lot of macroeconomic variables involved in environmental trend. If anybody had told me that in my lifetime, the whole world will be in lockdown, I would say it's not possible. If anybody has told me that Mecca in Saudi Arabia can be closed, that people will not perform Hajj. I will say, what on earth will lead to that? But I've witnessed it. If anybody had told me that I will see the Pope at the Vatican carrying his Bible himself without anybody carrying it for him and the umbrella for him, and we all saw this. So what I'm trying to say, look at such macroeconomic variable and the impact it has. That's an environmental issue. Or look at the political angle to the business side. You cannot tell the nature of politics that we call the noise that is being made in the U.S. We all know what is going on with respect to the forthcoming election in November. The whole world is interested because when U.S. sneezes, everybody catches cold. So we know that we are all interested because it's going to affect the policy at our own local environment. What about technology? Now, we've started seeing what people are doing with robotics. A lot of us have seen Alexa. I don't have to leave the comfort of my bed. When I wake up in the morning, I will just say, Alexa, what is the weather forecast today? And Alexa will tell me, Akim, the weather forecast today is 22 degrees. It determines the clothes I'm going to wear. Whether I'm going to wear my shirt, I'm not pressing any button. Alexa, play Shakiti Bob or Olamide for me. And he start playing till their kingdom come. That is technology. That was something that was not yet. And it's so cheap. Alexa is as cheap as 50, 40 pounds. So it is so cheap a technology. Now imagine somebody who is still developing another big system. And no, you've got to be alive to the industry where you are operating.
Exactly.
You must be wide awake. You cannot go to bed with one eye closed. You cannot. What about the regulatory changes? Governments change policy from time to time. What it is today is not what it was yesterday. And it's always not going to be the same. Somebody asked me a question. Is it good, for example, to buy a motorbike, Okada, and start Okada business? I said, well, it is not a bad idea. But then you must ask yourself, what if a law comes tomorrow and ban them? He said, oh, this is Nigeria. I said, yes, because it is Nigeria, they can ban it. So you cannot take it for granted. You must make provision for that. And that is why it's also important to always ensure that you take insurance policy. I hope to get to that as we progress. Then the business trend as well. You need to have an appreciation of the trend in the business in terms of the profit margin in that particular industry where you are operating. What is the profit margin like in the industry? Is it rising or is it falling? If it is rising, why? If it is falling, why? It is important. A lot of people have gone into business and they fail. When we were growing up, there are quite a lot of us, and I'm very sure there are people who are older than me in this particular class and people who will be my contemporaries. When we were growing up, we were used to Fensic. There was no paracetamol. Fensic, aspirin was what we were using in those days. Have we bothered to ask ourselves why? Why is there no more Fensic? What killed Fensic? What killed it? The reality is that from available research, Fensic had an opportunity. A particular part of Africa found that Fensic could serve as a deodorant. So there was poor power supply. So they were putting Fensic in their refrigerator to prevent bad odor from the refrigerator. So the sale of Fensic, the demand for Fensic increased so high and it was selling. Rather than for instead of the researchers, the producers of Fensic, to investigate why the sudden surge in the increase in demand, they continue to produce. Unfortunately, power outage in that country was restored and everything came to normalcy, but they have overproduced. And this is a product with expiration date. So Fensic had more production that was required and they never recovered from that. And that was the end of that business. So the point I'm trying to make is that even when your sales is experiencing an increase, please don't just continue to smile to bank. Research why. You need to know why the increase in sales.
Oh yeah.
You need to understand, because whatever the reason could just go out like a flash of light before you you say Jack Robinson, you must understand, because it is such appreciation that will let you know how to either guide jealously or to know whether that is going to be an enduring profit or it's just a gain of the moment. It is important. You need to also have an understanding of the nature of innovation in your industry, whether it is accelerating or reducing. Today, whether we like it or not, technology is here to stay. There's no two ways about it. Technology is here to stay. Look at what we are doing today. I mean, we can go into quite a lot of things that were not in existence 15 years ago. 15 years ago, there was no WhatsApp, there was no Instagram, there was no LinkedIn. I was discussing with my daughter, who is only 20, and I was saying that when we were in school and then we were talking, and she said, oh, Daddy, are you saying that when you were studying as a university student, there was no Google? I said, no, where do you get Google? He said, what? Because I said, Google was only founded in 1996. He said, oh God, that must have been hell on earth for you guys. They cannot imagine a world without Google. They can't imagine. And you can imagine the fast pace. And when I look at it, how old are some of us that we are saying that in our own days, which is our own days, this is still my day. But things are moving so fast and so quickly, and we have to understand that the nature of industry and the kind of business trend. Now, let's look at the Michael Porter five forces. This is interesting, and I need you to pay attention to this in particular. Some of the questions that you will be having will be coming from this area, so it is important, and that is why I try to populate it. You will realize that in the slide that I had with us in my first session,
yes,
I put Michael Porter five forces, but sure, it was not this populated. So I decided to populate it now so that when we want to answer the questions, and then we can also draw our business plan at the end of the day, being very conscious of this. Michael Porter came up with this in 1979. He published his article in Harvard Business Review. And ever since then, it has been widely recognized and still very much in use. The reality is that it has also been heavily criticized. For those of us who will be interested in taking Michael Porter's model in our research later in our study. So we must bear in mind that it is not without faults like any other academic model. It has been criticized, but the fact that it is very pragmatic and still very relevant cannot be taken away. So these five forces looked at the threat of new entrants. Let me start with the rivalry among existing firms. The first thing you want to possibly look at is what is the nature of rivalry that exists among firms in the same industry. For the sake of this analysis, let's say the banking sector. You want to know the number of banks. You can't say you want to get a license to operate a bank without knowing how many existing banks we already have. Not just knowing how many banks, you also want to know how many branches each of them are. For example, those of us who are in Nigeria, there are some banks we even ask ourselves, do they still operate? Because they are very, very few. Like there is one they call, I want to remember the name of that bank now. It's not Sky Bank. It's from the north. It's one of those northern banks.
Unity Bank.
Unity, thank you. You can count at your fingertips how many of their branches you have seen. But look at the amount of crisis that the banking sector in the country has witnessed. That bank has not been shaken. They remain solid. You even ask yourself, who are the people that bank with them? So what I'm trying to say is that there must be something about it. This bank must have a niche that keeps it going.
Sure.
That is also able to survive. So when you want to look at it, you must not just be benchmarking yourself against the likes of First Bank that is already everywhere. Now, let's dovetail that to a smaller business. Like you want to start a computer business of yours, or you want to start fish farming, for example. I've seen a lot of people who come to me, I want to start a poultry business. And I say, oh, that's nice. He said, because my friend is doing it, and they say this and that. The question is this. What do you know about poultry? That's the question. Do you know you need a vet? Do you know that if one of your chicken is sick, you do not know in good time, before you wake up the next morning, the old chicken will be there. The all of them will be there. Do you also understand that you cannot run a poultry in a residential environment because of the pollution, because of the smell and their noise, and that your next door neighbor can sue you? The case of Abiola versus Ijeoma, when late Chief MK Abiola was living in Surulere, and he had to sue his neighbor because of the noise pollution of the poultry. And he won the case because such a business is not something you operate in a residential area. If you like, you can call your neighbor a winch or a whatever. You are not supposed to operate it. So you need to understand the regulation that guide managing a poultry, as simple as it may appear to you. So these are the things. So you need to know the nature of rivalry you have. How many are the numbers of your competitors? And I will get to how we can get information about our competitor later. What is the level of diversity of your competitor? The level of concentration in that industry. Most of these are self-explanatory. The ones I'm going to explain are the ones I feel, okay, maybe some of us might not have heard before. Like the switching cost, for example.
Okay, we have 10 minutes for this first one.
Okay, so the switching cost is, how much does it cost me if I'm moving from a particular seller to another? If it's going to cost me more, then the chances that I'm going to move is minimal. If, for example, for me to get a particular product, somebody is saying that, oh, you can get this product for 20,000 in whatever currency. Why are you paying 25,000 for it? But the person who is telling me I can get it for 20,000, for me to shift to another product that is recommending, it will cost me more to get to that particular product. Then my switching cost is high. The chances that I'm going to move is very low. So that is what you are saying. You have to look at the bargaining power of your suppliers as well. Suppliers are big. When you have very few suppliers, they have higher bargaining power. But when the suppliers are many, you are at an advantage. Threat of substitute is another. Well, substitute can be existing substitute, which are products you already know. Now, how many of them do you have? Then substitute can also be direct substitute, and then you have the indirect substitute. Coca-Cola at some point, Coca-Cola as an organization, with their product Coke, was the number one brand name in the world for many years. It's got so bad in most parts of Africa that people get to stop. And even when they want to buy Sprite, they just say, I want to buy Coke. It became a household name until Google take over. The number one brand name in the world today is Google. And the way people say Google, when they want to talk now, you just say, Google it now. We have forgotten completely that Google is actually the name of the company. We use Google as if it were an English word. But that is how much the product has registered its brand name in the minds of people. And that is what every seller, every producer must strive to do so that you can get such level of loyalty. Again, the bargaining power of your buyers. Buyers have a lot of bargaining power if they are very few. But where there are a large number of buyers or customers, then they will be at your mercy. And then threat of new entrant. You must always emphasize that as you are building a school, that you want to start running a school in this area, trust me, do not be surprised by next month that somebody is having another foundation.
That's correct. So
you may be thinking, oh, there's no such, I'm the only one here. And you went to bank, take a lot of money. Before you finish your foundation, somebody in the next street is starting and is doing the same. And you can't stop it. You can't, because there's no regulation that stops it. So you must also always emphasize that what if this happens? And so that you don't run into problem with your banker. So the Michael Porter Five Forces is something we can have a read more on, but I've
completed
it with
very good
quite a number of those.
Very good.
Now, when you have an appreciation of that, then you go ahead to understand what to do, a market analysis, and then what we call market competitor analysis. Your market analysis will give you what we call the qualitative and quantitative assessment of the market as it were, in terms of understanding the value of the market itself. What is the value? What is the type of, what market segment do we have? What is the buying pattern? of the people? What is the nature of the competition that happens in that particular sector? You must have an understanding of all of this. That is what you call market analysis. If you're writing a business plan, usually your chapter 3 will be your market analysis. Sure. Market analysis is expected to be very detailed. Market analysis is not something you do by lying conveniently in your bed. You need to get out. It's just like somebody who is doing a PhD research. You cannot collect primary data by sitting in the house. Even if you conjure figure, on the day of your viva, you will meet the likes of Professor Okebukola, who have seen it all. They know. Because viva is just for you to come and attest to the fact that this is my work. And if you have not done the research, it will be evident. There is no two ways about it.
Oh, yes.
It will be very evident. So, then in the market competitor analysis, you need to understand SWOT analysis is useful here. What are the strengths and weaknesses of my rival? You must do an objective assessment. Please, 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 let me also say that it is not always easy for you to be the only one to do this. You may have to consult experts, but you can also do it on your own, depending on the amount of time you are ready to invest. It is always better to invest such time at the beginning than doing it when you have already get your fingers burnt. You must understand what is the strength and weaknesses. Then you must be able to figure out any opportunities in all of this. Look at with the COVID-19. Do you know that there are some people that make so much money? So much money. And I'm talking legitimate money. So much. Everybody, the only thing we were doing during the lockdown was eating. So food business was good. Absolutely good. And we know that immediately after it, another sector that is likely to enjoy is the care sector. Care sector, especially in the developed world, because there were a lot of domestic abuse. There were a lot of violence. Husband and wife got into each other's spaces. A lot of people were filing for divorce because they couldn't tolerate each other. So lawyers started smiling. Immediately they started unlocking. So you must look at it. And that is the way you analyze business. If you want to be unduly sentimental, you say, so why should anybody be happy that people are going for divorce? What is my own? Am I the one that asked them to? I'm a lawyer.
5 minutes more.
I'm a lawyer. That's just not my business. And that's the way you are. So in business, please, we always say, people say there is no ethics in business. I don't agree. There is no sentiment in business, but there is ethics in business because you must always do your business in an ethical manner. But there is no sentiment. The moment you introduce sentiment, you are in trouble. Quickly, competitor analysis is also important, laying credence to where I'm coming from. So when you have an appreciation of your competitor and you are able to put them in different segments, you can be able to do the needful. Now, how do you identify your competitors? There are three categories I have put together here. One is direct competitor, those that are selling identical or similar product with you. Look at beverage industry, for example. Even in the food and beverage industry, you talk of Milo and Pompita. They are direct competitors, right? If you talk about soft drink, Pepsi Cola, Coca-Cola, these are direct competitors. But they also have indirect competitor. Indirect competitor to soft drink will be anybody who is selling, what do you call it, juice, orange juice. It's an indirect competitor. And those who are diabetics, who doesn't want any of that, will go for water. So anybody selling water is a threat to soft drink industry. So you must understand. So when you are doing your market analysis and competitor analysis, you must be deep. You must be deep about it. That if you are selling in a university campus, for example, if you are now looking at only those who are selling something that you are selling and you are neglecting those who are selling water or pure water, then you are making a huge mistake. Your analysis is incomplete. And the third one is the future competitors, those that are yet to come in. They are neither direct nor indirect. They are even yet unborn. But trust me, they can knock on the door the next minute. You must always envisage it. And that's why I always say to people when they do market analysis, if you do your market analysis and you now see that the gap in the sector is 10% gap, you now say that, out of this 10%, I'm targeting 5%. Who are you to target 5%? Why did you just target 0.5%.
Yeah.
And then consolidate on that. 5% is too ambitious. Because while you are thinking of it, how many other companies do you know that Bank of Industry have just given loan to? How many do you know have just got money from microfinance bank? You don't know. And these are things you must bear in mind. Now, how do you know how to collect information from, about your competitor? What are some of the things you need? Sources of competitive intelligence. Okay? Some of the things you need to understand about your competitor include information that you gather about them with respect to the nature of competition that is happening, how they are operating, what is the kind of ethical issues that affect it. You must bear in mind when you want to do it. How? For example, I cannot walk into a store like a mystery shopper. You know who a mystery shopper is? Mystery shoppers are those who work with an organization and then go to another branch and pretend. For example, let's say I work with ShopRite. I work with ShopRite in the head office. And I come to the ShopRite in another particular brand, and just like any customer, and I will be walking around the store. I will just be walking around the store pretending to be buying things, and I'm looking at the name. When you see name badge on the customer service, it's not for anything. It's for you to be able to identify whether or not you have been well served. And if you want to make a report, you can put the person's name. So a mystery shopper can just come into pretend. But you cannot pretend to be a mystery shopper in your competitor's store. No, you can't. It is unethical. So what are some of the ethical ways of getting information about our competitors? One of those is you can attend conferences and trade shows. Those competitors are also likely to be there. If they are not there, there will be a directory, a business directory that will list all such businesses. So you can have more information about those who are competing with you or those who are doing the similar thing that you are doing. You can buy your competitor's product and look at what is it that you can do differently. What additional value can you put on this? You can buy their product. You can go to their website.
Good.
You can study your competitor's website very well and try to do a critique of it. What is it that you can do differently? You can set up a Google or a Yahoo email alert. When you set up a Google or Yahoo email alert, whatever that is about your competitor, you will always get an email. You will always get email about it, and you will get it updated from time to time. You can also read books about similar things. You can read books. I see when I see some of our young girls today, there is nothing they cannot cook. Nothing. All they need to do is to go on YouTube. Just type it, how to cook jollof rice. Type it. You will see different videos on how to cook jollof rice. You will start seeing it. So you can read about some of these things. And finally, you can talk to customers about what actually motivates them to buy your product or buy the product of your competitor as against yours. Even a customer that always comes to you, where you barb your hair, your barber must know. I remember when I was staying in Nigeria and I traveled for 3 weeks. I came abroad for 3 weeks and then I now went back. I now alleged the barber shop where I operate. I alleged the woman. I said, "Madam, you are not nice. You've not seen me for 3 weeks and you know I barb every week. And you didn't even bother calling me. You didn't check on me." She said, "Oh, God, sorry. I would have called you." I said, "How would you have called me? You don't even have my number." That day, that woman ran to buy a book and I told her, get the number of your customers. Get their birthday. Send them birthday message on their birthday. Just happy birthday, wonderful. Sir. This wonderful. And that and that. I said, it goes a long way.
Oh, yes.
If you know that I come every week, you have not seen me for 2 weeks. A short message. Sir, I hope everything is fine. We've just not seen you. We hope you are good. Please continue to stay safe. I said, it is brilliant. My next availability, it is your store. I will come back. And these are little things. If banks can now be sending us birthday message, my business registration in Nigeria, even banks send birthday message to my business. Birthday, say London corporate advantage, happy birthday, London corporate. I said, look at these people, even to business. Well, the birthday is the day I registered the business as far as that. So if one can do that, who are you that you cannot do it to your customers? You run a school, you must have all these things and occasionally attend. I think if you can do some of these, our industry and market analysis can be sharper. And we'll
wonderful,
be
wonderful.
Once again, thank you so much.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. I've not seen a thing like this. This is most illuminating. You may wish to stop sharing your screen, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, thank you. This is a very illuminating presentation. Very, very rich indeed. Several things. You can see Professor Samala Mande is already smiling. He's already happy because he's a global marketer. And he's able to see that your thoughts and his converge in, especially this last slide. This last slide is extremely important, extremely important. And I'm sure also that all our students like David and all of, you can see Mercy Ibe. Mercy Ibe, I hope you are noting because you are in the front line of a business. So I hope you are noting all of this. Though this is a real practical examples, case studies. Professor Ajumbadi, you may wish to stop sharing your screen so that we'll see everybody. And I'll be able to take a few minutes of interaction with them. You can even see Professor Kola Rahim. I had to come all the way from Accra, Ghana. Professor Kola Rahim had to come from Accra, Ghana to come and listen to this. So if you are hoping to set up a business, this is industry analysis at its best. How you analyze the industry before you venture, and even while you are there, how you can sustain. So if you want to take the floor, Professor Ajumbadi, as I kindly requested, maybe you want to stop sharing your screen.
Oh, I thought I've stopped. Sorry.
No, it's still on. It's still on.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, okay, that's fine. That's fine. Thank you very much. So if there's anybody who wants to take the floor, this is the time, so to do. We just want one or two. Oh, you can see Professor Abayomi Arigbabu is still here with us. Of course, he is the leader. He is taking an award as the university that is most entrepreneurial. Yeah, so let's have one or two quick comments and we'll move speedily to the next topic. Apparently, we have all enjoyed it. It's so laden with practical examples. So Professor Ajumbadi didn't just come here and be telling us market analysis, but he gave us examples of how to get this thing done. You can see Okore is also nodding his head. Okore, because Okore owns a school, is the principal of a school. And so he has learned quite a lot, you know, from this lesson. David is telling us this practical experience that we have all learned. So thank you so very much. And I would like to close the session now would like to appreciate him. He will be getting our notes of appreciation later. So let me bring this class to a close with much appreciation. So let us give a round of applause to Professor Akeem Ajumbadi for another very brilliant